Good evening and welcome to a beautiful and sunny Switzerland for lead final number one of 2017, live from Villars.
Perched at 1,300 metres above sea level and with a staggering view of the Rhone Valley, Villars is a small village in the Swiss canton of Vaud. Most of the residents around here live in classic alpine chalets and the village retains a quiet and peaceful feel. It is, however, a very international place, being home to two of the most exclusive international boarding schools in the world, including the perfectly situated Beausoleil College in the village centre, which enjoys surely the most distracting classroom view of any school on earth. This is the IFSC's second visit to Villars, and it is already a favourite amongst athletes and support crew alike.
And now our eight male and eight female athletes will be competing on two routes set by an extremely strong route setting team led by Chief Remy.
My name is Remy Sama. I'm the chief route setter here in Villars. And so we start work 5 days ago to prepare the World Cup. The process first is to imagine the line, to have something beautiful to see. And this year in the wall we have new volumes, big pink volumes. So it's really changed the world compared to last year. So first we try to have the line and to see what could be nice to see, and especially with the both category, men and female. And after we try to put the volumes. And the volumes, small volumes or medium volumes, to prepare the line. And on third time, after we start with holds, and we put the holds on the volume, and we imagine every movement, every sequence. This is a process. After, we don't have a lot of plan before, and when we are in the lift, and when we share with the other setter, we walk, and that's at this time we imagine some good movement, and depending also on where we are in the routes. First, we start by the finals. We set, we are four route setters, so we walk by team, two by two, in two lifts. So we start to put the first holds for the final routes, men and women. After, we try on the same place, we put the semi-final routes. And after the second and the third day, we climb the routes, we adjust all the routes. And the third day, at the end of the day, we take off all the holds and volumes from semi-final and final, and we start after to set the qualification. And we have all what we need, a lot of holds, a lot of volumes, so it was very, very nice to set here. This year the rules change, and climbers have only 6 minutes to go to the top of the final. So that's why we decide to have short routes, tricky routes, with like every time with some spectacular movement, and I really want for this year more tops.
And I'm very pleased to say Loic Timmermans joins me this evening. Actually, worked out this is your third World Cup in a row, which includes Schiermann and Kranz, so thank you for joining us.
It's a pleasure, thank you.
And we've just seen Remy and his team working on the routes. You and I were up on the stage just a minute ago. What's your first impression of both the men's on the right and the women's on the left?
The routes look like amazing. It's a big show, the holes are all brand new, and it's going to be a really amazing show, I think.
Both routes look quite powerful, but they're quite different as well, hey?
Yeah, the men's route is really powerful from the start. The women's route is a bit easier in the start, but then it gets really hard towards the roof. And the end is, the both routes have a really pretty bouldery end, and it's gonna be a tricky end.
Of course, the route setters are trying to achieve separation. They don't want climbers tied on scores. They want each climber to do slightly better or worse than the last one, so that we have a clean separation of the athletes. And unfortunately, speaking of which, a lot of people will have seen you in the semi-final this morning. Just mention briefly what happened. It was on the cross-through move.
There was a bouldery move in the center of the route, and I just didn't stick it, but I just had to find the right confidence for the next World Cup, and I think that I will be through one day.
But you feel that your form is good, and you think you can make some finals this
year?
Yeah,
the problem is that I think that all the semi-finalists have the shape to be in the final. And now it's only based on who's getting the right villa, who's climbing the best on that route.
Okay, I promise we won't mention it again. I know you were disappointed, but as I said to you earlier on, you've only got 5 days until you get a chance to put it right.
Exactly.
And there we go, there's our first good look at our routes, as I say. Women are on the left, there with the green volumes at the top, men on the right. And it is a beautiful evening here in Villars. We had an extremely violent thunderstorm at about 4 p.m. It rained really hard for about half an hour, and it's still wet on the ground. The wall seems to have survived relatively intact. It's still humid, still feels very moist here. And there is your women's starting list. The men will climb first, followed by the women. When the women do come out, it'll be two Austrians out first. Hannah Schubert, then Jessie Pilz. Mathilde Becerra, the French representative. Mina Markovic, the first of two Slovenians. Annette Verhoeven. Janja Gambre, Laura Rigora in her first ever World Cup. And Jane Kim, who qualified first at the semi-final, will climb last in the final. And in the men's competition, Domen Skofic, the nervous weight, watching the climbers finish off. It looked like he might got knocked out, just about made it. Last year's overall World Cup winner, Yuki Hadda, joins him, as does Romain de Grange, crowned European champion just 1 week ago at Italy. Jörg Verhoeven, no stranger to the business end of World Cups, will be out fourth. Jan Hoyer, who we normally see in bowling competitions, a lot of people very interested to see how he gets on. His compatriot Christoph Hanken will follow him. Sean Bailey is out. He came fourth here in Villars last year. Fedez of Ukraine will be out eighth. As I say, the men will climb first. It's eight men, eight women. And the crowd slowly building here in Villars. Then you're filling up nicely. A few people waving to the camera as well, they might. We didn't have a huge crowd here last year in Villars, but slightly better this time around. And it's filling up nicely. As I say, beautiful evening. And you might be able to hear through my microphone Christopher, the venue MC. He'll be at all the French and Swiss events.
The legend himself.
He is a legend. You can see him there just wandering around the stage. And he's just announcing that we've got 3 minutes to go before the presentation of the athletes. As you can see, the sun's still just about out here in Villars. We had a lot of problems with the sun in the semi-final. Scorching heat for the early climbers.
Yeah, for example, I climbed sixth in my semi-final route, and the sun was still hitting on the wall. I even had the sun right in my face, so it was pretty tricky to climb actually this morning. Some other climbers who were climbing later were more in the shade, but none of this tonight. Tonight it's all in the shade. A bit cooler, we had a nice storm this afternoon, so the weather really feels a bit more humid, but definitely cooler. And I think the conditions are really perfect to see some good climbing tonight.
Yeah, it feels like conditions are improving by the minute. When I got to the venue for the second time today at about 5:30, it was still hot, really humid. The rain was still in the air. It wasn't still raining, but you could still feel it. But it's really improving now. It is. Temperature is dropping. The humidity is dropping.
Yeah.
Can expect a good show.
I would love to climb right now.
Very relieved that the rain stopped as well. I really can't overstate just how hard it rained. So just run you one more time through our start list. We'll be the men out first. Domen Skofic will be out first. Nervous weight, just made it into the final, but he had a nervous semi-final. Yuki Hadda, Romain de Grange, Jörg Verhoeven, Jan Hoyer, Christoph Hanke, Sean Bailey and Fede Samoilov of the Ukraine are your eight men. And in the women's competition, Christopher just getting the crowd pumped up, trying to get some crowd extra so we can see him doing his thing, waving his paper around. Backwards cap and the sunglasses. You can either pull it off or you can't. And in the women's, I was just about to say, Hannah Schubert, she was delighted to make it into this evening's final. Spoke to her earlier, she said there's no pressure, doesn't really care what happens. She just wants to climb well.
She couldn't believe it, actually. Yeah, after her climb.
She had a really good qualifier as well. And watched the top, the right hand of the two women's qualifiers, and looked strong in the semis. Makes it through. She'll climb first. She'll be followed by Jessie Piltz, Mathilde Becerra, Mina Markovic, Anna Grohoven, Janja Garnbret, Laura Rigora, 16 years old in her first ever World Cup, and Jane Kim. Not her first World Cup, but had a superb semi-final. Comes through in first place in the semi and climbs last. Today the climbers come in reverse order. If you qualify highest in the semi-final, you climb last in the final.
On va commencer avec des légendes et ensuite rappelez-vous que ceux qui ont fait les meilleurs résultats pendant les demi-finales sont presque inconnus dans de l'univers de la difficulté.
So now we have presentation of the athletes. Christopher is going to introduce him.
On y va, le premier.
We'll try and listen to what Christopher's saying and keep you informed as well. He normally comes out with some gems.
Yeah, he's speaking French, so I can understand everything he's saying. All the jokes, all the all the stuff.
Here comes Domen Skofić. As I say, after his semi-final, he's delighted to be here, looked a relieved young man when we saw him leaving the venue earlier. Just to give you a bit of a heads up, we did manage to conduct some interviews with some of the finalists, so at the start of some of the climbers' attempts on this final route, we'll also simultaneously show their interviews that we got after the semi-finals. Domen was one of those climbers who see his interview when he starts climbing.
Here is Yuki Ada, the only Japanese guy in the finals. So it's not really like the Bouldering World Cups where we have really strong Japanese field. Here we only have one, but I think he's really strong and all the other Japanese are following not so far behind him.
We didn't see Aki Noguchi at this lead World Cup. We sometimes see her. She might have been certainly a potential finalist. She's not here. That man is though, Romain Legrange. He's like a fine wine, seems to get better with age. Won a World Cup last year, just crowned European champion. He seems to defy age. Very much a contender to win this World Cup in here in Villars. Remember the defending champion from Villars 2016, Sean McColl. He's not here this weekend. So somebody this evening will become the second man to win a Villars World Cup. Jörg Verhoeven out onto the stage looking relaxed as ever. Trying to get a sneaky look at the routes.
Yeah, it's the first time I've been competing with Jörg. Usually I used to look at him and he's really relaxed at competitions. And here is Jan. I think everyone is pretty curious to see what he can do on the route. We've been discussing with the route setters and we have some jumps, some bouldery moves. I think he might like the route.
Christoph Hanke from Olsching, Germany, joins his compatriot Jan Hoyer.
He had a great climb in the semi-finals. He looked pretty, really, really strong actually. And I think he has more the really power and the resistance, while maybe Jan only has the power for the moment. So gonna be interesting.
Well, we saw Jan's tactic in the semi-final. It just seemed to be climb as fast as you can. And,
yes.
And it worked a treat. It worked great. Here's Sean Bailey. Fourth last time out here.
He was also a finalist last year.
Yeah, Chamonix last year was his first World Cup. Had a good year last year, fourth here in Villars. He also made the semis in Briançon, Chamonix, Arco, Cran. You might remember he missed isolation in Cran. Here's Fede. This is his first final, and he qualified first out of the semi. They are eight male finalists. Jan and Jörg seem to be having a good old chat as well.
Yeah, as well.
Both look pretty relaxed.
And Jan is a bit taller than he did the rest, actually.
Yeah.
So you just watched him right now?
He's a slightly leaner Jan Hoyer than we'd seen in previous years. He's still massive, basically, but slightly slimmer than we've seen in the past. That was a conscious effort from him. I think he felt he was too heavy. He has trimmed down a bit. Looks in really good shape.
What I like about climbing is that the height doesn't really matter. Some strong climbers are really small, some are really, really tall. Here you can see Jan is really taller, but Fedir is like the opposite of Jan, and they are both in finals. And some moves are harder for the smaller guys, and the opposite as well. So yeah, it's always interesting to see climbers go through the routes.
Also interesting to see the often in bouldering we see the athletes really swapping a lot of beta. It seems this men's observation, everyone just kind of keeping themselves, swapping the odd bit of advice.
Yeah, well, maybe they will chat me later, maybe behind the wall. Maybe they like to focus right now on their own lecture.
Athletes wandering around all over the place to get a better view. Jan, the only man left on the stage. Now he makes his way off as well. Of course, the climb is so overhanging that from the stage you actually can't really see the top, so they're forced to move back further and further from the wall. Christophe Bion, our technical delegate, who we interviewed. You can see that on the IFSC Facebook page, explaining about the history of league climbing competition. It's really interesting to pick Christophe's brains. He's been around a long time. Check that out on the IFSC Facebook page. So Jorg and Roman back on the stage. Yuki Hada stays right where he is. You can see around him all the moisture on the ground from where it rained earlier. From what I can see and what the route setters say, we didn't get any seepage through the wall. They've covered the wall really effectively here in Villars. We're not expecting the rain to cause any problems beyond maybe a bit of humidity in the air. Still a somewhat grey sky, though. I hope the rain holds off. No, not forecast the rain.
Hopefully not. Here you can see the holes on the wall. There are some really new holes on there. All of cheetah, I think. And they have some dual texture holes, which are really hard to read and which are hard to grab because they have some plastic and some friction. So I think when they are reading, they're also looking for the plastic where it is, so they know where to hold the hole. The also new thing is that they like to put some dual texture on the footholds, which is even trickier than before because now you have some slipping footholds and it gets just trickier and trickier every year.
We saw that a bit in the Bouldering World Cup so far this season, where the route setter seems to be looking for even more precise footwork.
Yeah, but hopefully in bouldering you can try again if you slip.
But that's very true.
In the lead, if you slip on the second quick throw,
it's over. It is one of the elements of league climbing that's so interesting, is the fact that you only get one shot, and it makes consistent athletes even more impressive. You look at someone like Anna Verhoeven in the women's, just seems to consistently make finals. I think I counted 29 World Cup or World Championship in a row where she's been to the final, and to just not make a mistake.
Yeah, it's really demanding. In terms of concentration, you have to be focused, like really from the first hole. You have no, you can't do really any mistake, and it can be frustrating by times. Just feel you didn't climb your best, and you want to try again, and then you just have to wait for the next competition.
Just a quick heads up about our live stream. Apparently we were having some internet issues earlier on today. The stream was jumping. I can only apologise, I'm told that because of the geographical location of Villars, it's impossible to get really, really fast, reliable internet here. I can't honestly say I understand why that is, but that's what I'm told. The stream, I'm told, is reliable provided you watch the one on the IFSC website homepage. So don't go to YouTube. If you're on YouTube, get over to the IFSC homepage. Remember, you can get in touch on Twitter, hashtag IFSCWC. Lurk Timmermans is here alongside me. If you have any questions for an elite lead climber, get them on Twitter. Climbers have now got 24, 3, 2, 1, 20 seconds left of observation before they'll start to be herded off the route. Jan and Jorg again seem to be swapping beta. They were swapping banter earlier, now beta. Jorg, of course, lives in Innsbruck, fluent German speaker. And that, according to the timer, is time up. And yes, the climbers are now being ushered off. And as ever, they crane their necks for one final look.
Yeah, the route is not too long, so we won't have any time out, I'm thinking. Except if someone is really resting everywhere, but I'm not expecting any timeout this time. The route is not too long, it has a powerful start, so they won't be able to rest that much in the start. And the end is just bouldery with a lot of big volume. I think they will be climbing pretty fast.
So we don't have any climbers who are tied throughout the qualifiers and the semi-finals in the men's competition. We had a lot of ties in the men's semi-final, but the climbers were all separated in the qualifiers, so if we have a tied score between two climbers, it will come back to count back to the previous round, and if they happen to be tied in the semi-final, then we count back to the qualifying round. Slightly different in the women's competition, slightly more complicated, but we'll cross that bridge when we come to it.
Looking at the wall right now, you can see the big pink volume in the center. This is a new volume from this year. It wasn't there last year, and it's really a big change because the overhanging part is really now a bit longer than last year. Now you can really stand actually on the pink volume on the top there, and it's making a real change actually. Now you can really do some bouldery moves where you stand and you can do some coordination moves. So the route setters have been really creative this year. They like to do some changes, of course.
So we are now seconds away from our first climber. Christophe Bion, who I mentioned earlier, the IFSC technical delegate, just seems to be checking some last minute details. I think he's telling the photographers how far he'd like them to encroach on the stage. And as I said, we've got a big and growing crowd here in Villars. Stanislav Kokorin in the Czech shirt.
So I think he's motivated.
Yeah, silver medal yesterday in the speed final.
Nice
to see he's hung around to watch the lead climbers as well. I saw some of the speed climbers heading off today for holiday or last minute training session before they head off. Speed climbers won't be in action now until Arco. We were originally scheduled to have speed in Chamonix, but it will just be lead now. And actually, from here in Villars, you can see the mountains of Chamonix. Extraordinary view here. You can look across at Mont Blanc on a clear day. And we will be there in just 3 days' time.
So the first climber out will be Domin. He's the winner of the general ranking last year. I think we can see someone climbing really high from the first climb around, so I'm expecting, yeah, the first climber to climb really high this time. Usually the first climber out is the one who placed the worst in the semifinals, but the semifinals were so tricky that everyone fell around the same movement, so you can't really say who was the strongest on this single move. So we can really expect anything from the first climber in this route.
Yeah, it's a good point you make. There wasn't a big difference between people in the semi-final. Dom and out first, certainly not out the question that we could see the winner climb first. It's going to be very tight in this both men's and women's semi-final. As I mentioned earlier, the right-hand route there, black, yellow and black, that's the men's route on the right. Black, green is the women's on the left.
If you look at the top of the wall, you can see there are really not many holes left on the top in the women's. Maybe we'll keep it for later, but it looks really, really creepy, really strange end. And in the men's, it's even actually the same. You have some really big holes, but there are actually no holes on it, and just have to stand, and it's really some bouldery movements. We could actually see that kind of movements in bouldering World Cups, and now they are just on top of the leaderboard. So I'm pretty curious to see someone climbing until there.
You can see them on that women's route heading for that top green hole. It actually looks quite an unnerving move. The quick draw will be hidden out of sight beneath you, and you'll just be creeping up that pink slab with the rope trailing seemingly into nothingness. It'd actually be quite an unnerving position.
Yeah, if someone falls there, I think it could be scary. But I know, for example, Yan Kim, even if she's climbing for, like, I don't know how many years, she's still sometimes, like, a bit scared when she's falling. So if there is anyone scared out there about climbing or lead climbing, just know that Yan Kim is also sometimes scared when she's falling. And here is Domen.
So Domen comes out. Hopefully we can hear what he thought after his semi-final this morning.
He also climbed really well last week in the European Championship.
Like, the semi-final route were really easy, I think even easier than qualifiers, especially the second one was, I think, way harder. And up to the leap was also like super good rest, and then just like a really tricky sequence with actually really technical. And I mean, if you did it like right, it would be okay, but if you did it right, that could cost you going out of the finals because you didn't stick the next hold. I don't like such a way, but yeah, so that's why I was up to the last competitor. I was actually out of the finals, but now I'm luckily in. But I don't like to be going to the next round on this way.
I'm sure he'd rather go that way than not at all. Wasn't over the moon this morning, Domen, but just about got in. And it's our first chance to look at this men's route. While I was listening to him, also watching him, and he's seemingly quite untroubled so far. But this is where this men's route gets really tricky. The route setters are saying you can camp a sixth section if you choose,
or you can do it more in a static way. And I was actually guessing that Domen would do it this way. I know he's really a heel hook lover, so yeah, I was expecting him to put a heel hook there. So now he will enter the traverse, which can be a hard sequence, the visitors were saying. This is probably the first a bit tricky hard route movement.
Yeah, moving off this black volume is one of the early cruxes. Domen, no trouble whatsoever. His experience of the Boulder World Cups this year could well come in handy. He did 5 Boulder World Cups this year. He's only missed Mumbai. Best result of 29th in Vail and Meiringen. So we shall see if that experience comes in handy. Doesn't like that black cheetah hole. Just uses it for the heel. He's only been climbing 2.5 minutes, Dom, and he's approaching two-thirds of the way up the route.
Yeah, once he will be over the lip here, he will be almost standing, and it's going to be a really different climbing from there on. Now he has like one or two more powerful moves, and then it's going to be the more bouldery movements.
So Domin setting the early standard here, first climber out. Once he's done, all he can do is wait.
He looks really solid, they're really fresh there. And now he's going to stand up there. Another heel.
Eyeing the quick draw, just trying to figure out how to clip. Not the easiest clipping position, his left foot just adding a bit of friction to the rope. And he's on to the head wall itself, climbing in the spotlight. Darkness descends here in Villars. Crowd getting into this.
He's clipping the last little quick throw, and now he's going to be all the bouldery moves. And he's still talking, that's amazing. He's really fresh.
Yeah, he's got 2 minutes left, so time not likely to be a factor unless he takes long rest. He's heading up for two very small crimps, and he's off. From just beside the final quick draw, Domin Skofic.
Yeah, he looks pretty fresh until he actually fell. Maybe the volume, he was losing friction on the volume, he was a bit hesitating, and I think he lost friction at some point. These volumes are really tricky. Once you start hesitating, they get really slippery, and you often don't want to grab them too much. You want to grab them once and then really go for the next movement. But for a first go, this was a really good go.
Superb first effort from Domin. Into the final in eighth place. Hopefully we can grab a word with him before he disappears off into the crowd. Doesn't look especially tired coming past. As you mentioned, it doesn't look like it took that much out of him. Yuki Hara will be out next, and here he is. Light really fading here in Villars, just adding to the spectacle, and we've got a... Wow, I've just turned around for the first time in a while, and the crowd has quadrupled in size. Superb.
I was just hearing from Christopher, it's Yuki Hara's second final in the Lead World Cup.
Yeah, he made the final in Cran last year, finished eighth.
Now he's starting on the slopey side, which is powerful. You can't really stay there, you have to just climb through and go to the overhang, but hopefully the overhang is just right there.
Remember, we're on 6 minutes for these lead finals now, same as the semi-finals. It used to be eight, down to six.
Yeah, this is the first Lead World Cup with 6 minutes rule. Normally it should be no problem because the routes are not too long. We are not in IMS or a longer wall, so we won't see any timeout, I think.
Yuki, just keep an eye on the clock. He's been climbing for close on a minute. Been slightly slower on this lower section than Domin. But Domin wasn't pushed for time, and I doubt Yuki will be either. It's changed the route setter's job slightly, 6 to 8 minutes. They're really trying to avoid giving any really big rests. any big opportunities to burn too much time. You want the climbers to keep moving. Yuki, 4:28 left on the clock, as I say. It's not quite climbing as fast as Domin, but...
Yeah, he's also choosing for the static way, but now he did it with a right heel hook while Domin put a left heel hook. And he's not really waiting, he's just going through. He just keeps climbing.
Crowd enjoying this. And I believe we've got Domin Skofic available. Domin. Hey Domin.
Hello.
That was great to watch that on the route there. It looked like you absolutely cruised the lower third. Just talk us through it.
Yeah, actually I cruised it because it was, it was easy up to there, and then it's just another crux. Like every other route on this comp. No, the route is like really enjoyable to climb and everything is spectacular. But yeah, I would wish that I would do this move because I think a lot of people will actually want this move.
And just quickly, we're watching Yuki, but when you fell, did you just lose friction on the volume?
Yes, I actually that's why I wanted to go, but then I wasn't really sure about my position because the next hole was a slot. And I hesitated for a second, and then yeah, that was a horrible mistake because afterwards my arm just got like super sweaty and all of a sudden I lost the friction.
Okay, well it was great to watch you, glad you made the final and thanks for talking to us.
Thank you, I enjoyed it really much. Bye.
Yeah, while Domin was speaking, Yuki has been climbing amazingly, he's been jumping around. Here he just slipped on the anacling, but he had a total different way of Domin to climb the route. He just jumped the whole way through. It looked like a big boulder. He was just jumping all the time.
Yeah, I was concentrating on what Domin was saying and simultaneously watch Yuki.
I was trying to listen to Domin, but I was so amazed by Yuki jumping all the time that I was, wow.
Let's have another look at that last move. He just goes for the match.
It looks like the end of the route is really based on friction. Like Domin right just said, he just lost friction there. And I don't know, you have to somehow find a way to chalk enough your hands so they don't get too sweaty. And once you start climbing, you don't have to hesitate too much. You grab the hole and you just keep climbing. Otherwise, you might lose friction and slip off the route.
A couple of questions coming through on Twitter, hashtag IFSCWC, if you'd like to ask Loic Timmermans anything. I've got a question from Goose on Twitter. He says, Loic, predictions for tonight?
Well, I think it's too late. They already started. Predictions.
Come on, you don't get out that easy.
Okay. So for the first place, I will say, it's so hard. It's such a bouldery route, but maybe I'll say Romain.
Well, we're about to get a very quick clarification of whether you're right there. Romain de Grange is out.
And this is not too risky because he's just a fresh European champion, so I know he's in good shape. Jusqu'à il y a deux ans en arrière, il était très sensible au niveau du mental. Il fallait que je laisse tranquille un petit peu sur le départ de Vitebois. Depuis un an, il est papa. Et le fait d'être papa, ça lui a amené une résistance en arme. Il grimpe pour la petite rose. Et je peux vous assurer que le début de saison est butant pour Romain Desgranges. Il a remporté les Open les plus importants de la planète. Romain est un big fan de Crims. This route has more like bouldery and slopey holes, but I think he's really, really strong enough to do the bouldery moves as well. And I'm curious to see him on the last movement. But first, he has to do the bouldery sections and the powerful moves.
Yeah, he's extraordinary climber, Romain de Grange, just keeps on going at a world-class level. It's absolutely extraordinary. After an incredibly long climbing career, first World Cup was back in 2003. He had to wait to 2015 to win his first one, and then he won another one last year, 2016 European Championships. This year, keeps on going and seemingly keeps getting better.
He's doing the cross move here. He's finding the temp on the yellow cheetah hole. Yeah. I'm curious to see him jumping here. Will he do it statically or is he going to jump? And he's going for the static way. Yuki Hara has been jumping on this movement. That was so impressive. He did it the Japanese way, I think. Maybe he's been training with the bouldering Japanese climbers.
If you ever get the chance to go to Japan, anybody watching this, and see the training facilities, it is absolutely mind-blowing. Certainly paying off, particularly in the bouldering.
Yeah, I'm not sure they have a lot of lead climbing gyms. I think they have a lot of bouldering gyms.
Romain, the right hand just popped. He just about managed to hold it, but that looked a bit of a nervous moment for him.
I think he has to go again to the second yellow hole. Now he was just keeping the first one with his left hand. He should put a heel hook on the black hole. Oh, he's going directly. Perfect.
Romain, the feet come off, but he stays on. That look of determination in his face.
And he's still looking good.
He's a climber who fights and fights and fights. And people enjoy watching him. Wears his heart on his sleeve, lets you know what he's thinking.
So now it starts the friction-based sequences.
So that hold to his left, closer to our camera that he's moving towards now. That's where Domen was.
He's clipping the last quick throw.
Looked a slightly uncomfortable clip, but it's done now. If he makes another clip, it'll be at the top.
And he's taking the first position right now.
Romain de Grange cruising this top section. Now he'll move back right. The spotlight that he is climbing in now illuminates the top hole. That's how close he is. Oh, so close for Romain de Grange. That is the third to last hole he was on there.
And Amazing, I think.
Yeah, he gave that everything he had. He looks tired coming down. Shaking his head. Never really looks happy with his performance. But that was a pretty good effort. Put him into clean first place.
And the crowd is really pleased.
Yeah, breathing heavily, Romain. Let's have another look at it. So that big black volume that was level with his hip, that's the last foothold. It's enormous. It's a big foothold, but it will be the last thing he has his feet on. So he really was closer.
Yeah, and we have no Swiss climber in the final, so... Being close to France, I think the crowd was also pretty happy to see Romain climbing that high.
He lives in Chamonix, Romain. We'll be there in 3 days' time. It's about an hour and a half down the road from here.
In his hometown.
Yes.
And he's a bit pumped, so I think someone is helping him with his knot. So now you can tell he was pumped. But even the guy looks having some issues.
Yeah, just 3 days we'll be in Chamonix. For the Boulder World Cups, it was lots of flying and airport lounges, and all we've got to worry about in the next few days is one of the most scenic drives in the world, down from Villars, down to the Rhône Valley, over the Col des Monts and into Chamonix. A Look at Rotman powering through the roof. So solid on that crimp, as you mentioned.
Endo Scholar, though, is just really beautiful.
You can really see there is no hold on that hold there, and it's all based on friction. That one is just the same.
Here comes Jörg Verhoeven, and we can hear what he thought after the semi-finals.
I mean, this route was exactly what I came back to route climbing for. It's I saw last year that route climbing really, league competitions really changed drastically. It's much more bouldering, much more, I don't know, interesting to me. And I did Campitello, the European Championships, and I wasn't too impressed on the route setting. It was very crimpy, and this is exactly what I was looking for. So I had a good time. For me, this is just, you know, it was a bit of luck that I entered the final, so, and I don't have any expectations, but why should I? Like, my endurance is not the best. I'm like an old man making it to final, so whatever I do, I'm already happy. And maybe footsie for the first hole.
So I think Jörg is really happy with this final because, like he was saying, this final is all about bouldery movements, some really flat holes. I think he will just like it because it's not too long either, so he won't be. He doesn't have a lot of pump. He won't get pumped, I think.
Great quote from Jörg. Yeah. I'm just an old guy. Yeah. Might fall off on the first clip. He's certainly not done that. Really good mindset to be able to climb with. Just no pressure.
And Homa is even older, so no excuse, Jörg.
Yeah, born in 1985, Jörg Roman de Grange, 1982.
So let's see the first bouldery moves, little jump there. And he's going for the static. Nice.
Nice. Controls the swing really neatly. It was a dynamic move, but it never really looked in doubt because he just had the movement so perfect. Climbing nice and smoothly, Jörg. 3 minutes 40 remaining for him. You can see the fatigue just beginning to kick in, the leg just beginning to shake a bit. He'll take any opportunity to rest. It's not a great hold that he's resting on, but it's enough to get something out of it. Really, you can see him puffing his cheeks out, really beginning to work here. Now he's fighting.
Now he's getting pumped through.
That's a tiny hold for tired arms.
Come on, Jörg. He's pumped. Come on.
Easing his way up towards the top volume.
Wow. Big fight.
Ah. Just tried to get two moves in quick succession. It's just one move too far. You can see in that last pull over onto that yellow crimp, pump really kicking in. Big smile on his face. I think he had a good time.
Yeah, I think anyone falling after a big fight is just happy.
And Jörg makes his way off the stage. Just as a look at a finger, I wonder if he lost a bit of skin there. Try and grab a word with Jörg.
And now I think everyone is waiting for Jan Hoyer.
Interestingly enough, we, as well as seeing Jan in the lead, he also did the speed here in Villar with the pretty respectable time of 8.56.
And this is his very first lead final. He's been very close to finals in Ukraine when he skipped a lot of movements 1 year. And this time he looks really even more in shape than back then. The wall is good here, it's not too long. The route is pretty bouldery. I think he's going to climb pretty fast as well. Yeah, you can really see he has a tactic in mind. Will be interesting to watch the block here. So not even a minute and he's already like pretty far in the route. He's not taking a lot of rest.
As anticipated, climbing quickly here, York. Jan, sorry.
Jan,
just had York. Sorry, Jan. Keep an eye on the top of your screen. We've got the results coming across. Remember, in lead climbing, the name of the game is to get as high on the route as you can. And the holds are numbered. They're not visible. We can't see them on our live stream, but the route setters, before the competition begins, create a map of the route and number each hold, and it's a competition of who can get to the highest hold. Ideally, you want to get to the top. But if you don't get to the top, you get a number, which was the hold that you reached. So that is what those numbers correspond to. And as things stand, Romain de Grange has the highest number and he leads the way.
And Jan is doing an amazing job. He's only been climbing for 2 minutes and he's already on the top of the wall. He's being really, really efficient. I hope he doesn't rush it either and doesn't skip the quick draw there.
He just needs to remember to clip. It's not a normal part of his life in bouldering competitions.
Indeed.
Looked like he remembered just in time.
Come on.
And close from Jan Hoyer. Same hole that we saw Domen Skopić slip off, albeit in a slightly different place. And he just signals that his forearms were feeling that. I think he enjoyed that, but him and York seem to have a similar approach this evening. Just enjoy and see where it gets you. York Verhoeven, you just see him as you see, he's sitting about 5 meters away from us, just seems to have cut his fingers, a bit of blood coming off, I think his index finger on his right hand. It still looked like he had fun.
Yeah, the holes are all new, so the friction is really, really big.
So that's our current standings, Romain de Grange, Domen Skopić, Yuki Hada and York Verhoeven in top four, although Jan Hoyer will move up. Sorry, you were saying?
I was saying, yeah, the holes are really new and the friction is big, so the skin can hurt sometimes. And now we have yet another German, Christoph Hanke. I've been training with Christoph in May when I was on a training camp with Basti Halenke, and I'm pretty happy to see him in the finals because he actually injured his knee while training a couple of weeks ago, so he was pretty scared about the start of the season coming really soon, and now to see him in the final is just amazing.
Yes, first World Cup final. He's actually waiting for his first top 10 finish until this weekend. He's certainly achieved that and more. Final here in Villars. World Cup debut back in 2011 in Pours.
In my home country.
Exactly, Team Belgium well represented here.
Yeah, I've been competing with Christoph in the youth categories. And yeah, it's been always really nice to compete with him, with Basti as well, and the other youth.
So Christophe heading out right onto the bubbles. The two yellow volumes, the top one, that volcano. Figures out that he needs the right hand in it.
I think Christophe has a bit more resistance than York and Jan, for example. So I don't think he will be having any endurance problems on this route. Now it will be... We will see how he is going to deal with the bouldery moves. Like this one, for example. Come on.
He's just lining it up.
You have to go for it. Nice.
Looking solid at this stage.
Yeah, very solid. He's also climbing really efficiently.
Another climber. There seems to be quite a few in this competition that will just be delighted to be in the final. And that relaxed way of climbing is really paying off. Just needs to solidify here. He suddenly looked as if he got a maybe a rush of adrenaline, suddenly sped up for a minute. Just needs to dial it down again.
And this is the last rest before the last part.
Top of your screen, you can see the results coming across. Romain de Grange leads the way. He was Loic Timmermans' prediction for the win here, and he's doing him proud so far.
Come on.
Starting to get very physical. Top section of this route, and it's just a move over to the left. It looked like he got a bit of a surprise fall in there. His compatriot Jan Hoyers, only about 10 metres from the wall. Hearty round of applause from Jan.
And Romain is still leading.
Romain is still leading, yeah.
And that's a podium for sure for him, because we only have two climbers left, Sean Bailey and Fedir Samula. So Romain is for sure on the podium.
Really nice to see Jan waiting to congratulate him. I believe we're about to see the results, and there we go, there's our new graphic. And you can see where Romain de Grange got to, hold number 41. 37 for Domen Skoffic, 35 plus for Jan Hoyer. And here's what Sean Bailey thought after his semi-final.
The semi-final was good. It was a little easier than I thought it was going to be until we got to the head wall, and then the head wall was a lot harder than I expected it to be. And the kind of like crux hold was in the sun, and so it was like not usable, at least for me. So I had to try kind of some weird sequence. And then I think I ended up making it through just because I tried to do a cross and get a plus, and it was enough, so it's cool. Psyched for it to be my second final ever, yeah.
Relaxed as ever, Sean Bailey. And from one interview to the next, I believe we've got Jan Hoyer waiting. Jan, thank you for joining us. It looked like you enjoyed that.
Every bit of it.
You've been on the route. What were your tactics, and what do you think the key to the route is?
Well, I think it wasn't that hard to see. I knew I would be pumped super fast, so I climbed as quickly as possible. I think I'm happy about my performance, not just on this route, but this weekend. I always like climbed all right, climbed until I was pumped, and now I can see what it's worth. But well, when I knew I'm in semis, I felt like super happy. I didn't feel any pressure at all going into semifinals. And today, like every single move I was allowed to do in finals was, well, might have been the last first quick draw I clipped, the last second quick draw I ever clipped on the League World Cup final. So I made sure I just had a lot of fun on the route.
And it looks like that mentality of just being relaxed really worked for you.
It definitely helps going into a competition with no pressure. In semis, I beat a couple guys that are way better lead climbers, have more endurance. They just, I don't know, struggled at the crux, and maybe because of nerves, maybe because of something else. But for me, it was just fun to have the opportunity to climb on four routes, which is much more than I ever trained in the past couple months, four routes a day or in a weekend. So I think I have to be happy with my performance.
Well, we really enjoyed watching you. I know a lot of people did back home. So thanks for talking to us. Thanks for climbing. It was great to watch you.
Thank you.
It sounds like Jan will need a bit of a rest after this weekend, apparently.
Yeah, really good to hear from Jan Hooyeren. Really nice to see him in such a relaxed frame of mind.
Yeah, yeah.
And we've got a climber on screen now. He never seems to be in any other frame of mind. Sean Bailey, Team USA. Just slightly risky move there. That's the dual texture, the low friction part of the hold that he was using for that right foot. There is a tiny bolt on, but it's slightly superfluous. He managed to get something out of it, though.
Yeah, it's still very slippery. So now he should be with the left hand in his in the other hold, in the second yellow. So he's changing. Yeah, that's the right thing to do. Come on, Chen. Let's see the swing. Nice.
Sean cuts loose. About to pull on to the lower angle section of the wall. He'll first go up to that yellow volcano hold. And then he'll rock onto the black volume. Reach up with the left hand. There it is for the crimp. Looking in control at this stage. Just needs to keep himself close into the wall. I was just saying, it seemed like his hips began to move out.
He was slipping on a foothold there. He was still looking strong, but somehow his foot was slipping on the big black volume there. So Roma is still in the lead right now, and there is only Fedir Samoylov. Yeah, here we see his shoe slipping on the volume.
Yeah, Roman de Grange leading the way. Domen Skofic in second place. So those two already guaranteed their place on the podium. And there we see it. Roman 41, so no tops so far. Domen Skofic, second place, 37. Jan Hooyer is currently on the podium. He said he climbed with no pressure. Lee's not normally his thing. A bronze medal would be an extraordinary result. He said he was happy just to make the semi. Still one more climber to come, though. All Jan's Christmases will have come at once if he takes a bronze medal, though, when his aim was to make the semi. Fedir Samoylov makes his way onto the stage, gets a big round of applause. The MC, Christopher's just been getting the crowd pumped up to see him climb. Quick question on Twitter, actually, related to MCs and DJs, from Alesh Tapina. Do competitors get to pick the song they climb to? They do not.
No.
We have had a few incidents in the past where DJs have played slightly inappropriate songs.
Yeah.
But no, they don't get to choose their song. Personally, I think that would add to the show if they did. I think it's kind of like you see in professional wrestling. I think it'd be quite cool. But no, they don't. Good question, though. Thanks, Alesh.
Yeah, Federer has been really impressive in the semifinals. At the very hard cracks where almost all of the competitors fell, he decided to match a really, really small hole. And then he still climbed maybe 4 or 5 moves further, and he was really, really impressive in the semi-finals. This is also his first final, so it will be a good experience for him.
Very soon we're going to be able to speak to Sean Bailey. We'll just keep an eye on Fedir for now as he finds a half-useful knee bar. Obviously didn't like it that much, quickly moved on. And we've got Sean Bailey available now.
What's up?
Hey Sean, that was great to watch. What happened on that final move? Was that a slip or a mistake in your climbing?
It was a little bit of both. I made a couple mistakes right beforehand, and then my foot blew, and that was kind of the final deal. But yeah, a little combination.
And you had a really good 2016, made the first final of 2017. How are you feeling ahead of the rest of the season?
I feel good. I feel not quite 100%, so I think it means that I'll have some good events ahead of me, and yeah, I'm stoked.
Well, we were stoked to watch you. Thanks, Sean.
Yeah, thank you.
Fedim, meanwhile, fighting. Romain de Grange will be watching this nervously. Jan Hooy is about 5 meters from us. He could be on the podium. He was ninth last week in the European Championships, Fedir. 16th in the Paris World Championships back in September. And he qualified first out of the semi-final here in Villars, and he's powering up this men's route. You can see the fatigue kicking in though, the feet cut loose.
Yeah, but Fedir has a lot of endurance. So when you think he's getting pumped, he actually can still climb through. So let's hope he can go really further.
Really onto the meat of this route, onto the head wall.
Yeah, he's entering the friction-based holes there. A bit more bouldery sequences. He's finding a nice drop leader.
Really smooth performance thus far from the Ukrainian. Are we about to see the first and only top of this men's route?
He's even resting on this underclink. Looks like he wants to clip somehow. Maybe he will keep climbing.
2:49 left on the clock for him, so
and he's clipping.
Still plenty of time, but he just needs to figure out how to clip the just out of shot right now, but the B-layer was really struggling to figure out how much slack he needed. So overhanging this wall in Villars, the climbers aren't visible from the bottom.
And now he's going, he has to go far enough behind the big volume there, because there is a hole, but it's a bit further behind. Jan also missed the hole, and he has to commit a bit more to get the hole there. And here you can see the hole, it's also it looks like a dual texture hole.
Once again, the crowd getting fired up. We have a maximum of 2 minutes left in this men's final here in Villars. It seems to have just disappeared before our eyes.
He might be standing, but he is really, really pushing and fighting there. Come on, come on. Oh.
Not for Villars this time. Superb effort from him. Just seemed to hang on that final volume. Just trying to suss out what to do, trying to get a bit of life back in the arms.
And I'm having a look at Romain de Grange, and he's really, really happy.
So already this men's final completed, 9 o'clock here in Villars. Jan Hooy again, very close to us, still looking absolutely over the moon. So let's have a look at our graphics. There we see it. 35 plus for Jan Hooy, 37 for Dominic Scoffington there. Romain de Grange couldn't quite top the route, but he ends up with 41. He is the winner here in Villars. Fedir Samoilov just knocked out Jan Hooy. Both got 35 plus. He was awarded the plus, and he knocked Jan off the podium by virtue of count back to previous results. But fourth play for Jan Hooy, absolutely extraordinary. We'll just wait for that score to update. I can tell you Fedir did finish third. So everyone from and including Jan Hooy down gets shunted down one. Fedir is on the podium, third place for him in his first ever final. And there it is. once again. We'll see the graphic of where the climbers fell, so where Jan was marked will now be fed in.
Amazing. First final and first podium.
And there is the wall as the final rays of light disappear here in Villars. The climbers have been needing the spotlight for the last half hour or so, but darkness really is approaching fast. The women's final will take place almost entirely in pitch black, and how spectacular it will look, and what a spectacular performance from this man, Romain Desgranges.
Yeah, he's really in shape. I mean, he just won the European Championship. Now he's winning yet another World Cup, the first of the season. This might be the season of Romain Desgranges.
Stranger things have happened, that's for sure. Superb performance. He takes the win. 41. Reached hold number 41. Just great to get another opportunity to see it.
Yeah, you can really see that where Federer fell, Roma really took a big risk by going directly to the hole, and he didn't really hesitate too long, and that was the most positive thing, and that really helped him to go through the sequences there. He didn't hesitate, he grabbed the hole, and he just climbed through. We didn't see a top though in the route, so hopefully we will see one in the women's route. I was really curious to see the end of the men's finals, but now let's see the women's route.
Just have a final look at where the climbers got to on the wall. As you rightly say, no tops. That was Romain Desgranges' high point, hole number 41, 37. Domen Skoffic, who climbed first, and he held the lead briefly. And it's not Jan Hooyer in third place. That is where he got to, but he won't take third place. Semir Fedir knocked him off the podium, but that was Jan's finishing point. And it was also Fedir's, but Fedir took third place by virtue of count back to the previous round. And the women's final will follow very shortly.
In a couple of minutes.
And just looking at that women's final, your compatriot Anak, fresh from winning the European Championships. We can see the starting list on screen now. I was just about to say, Anak, she's just won the European Championship. She must be full of confidence.
Yeah, I think, she's really in shape. You could see it at the European Championship in the final, where all the girls fell. I think the girls fell at around the hole 35 or something, and Anak fell around hole number 50, so she climbed 15 movements further. Yeah, she was really, really in shape back then, and she still is. But now we have a World Cup, so this means Jan Kim is also in the game, and Jan Kim is first after the semifinals, so it will be interesting to see maybe a new kind of battle with Jan Kim, Janja, Anak, and maybe who knows if Laura Rogora, who was doing her very first final, being only 16 years old, and yeah, I'm really curious to see the women.
Yeah, that was an extraordinary performance from Laura Rogora earlier on today. 2016, as you say, this is her first World Cup. Very shortly we'll be able to speak to Romain Desgranges. Before we do, his compatriot Mathieu Becerra will also be out in the women's competition with the two Austrian climbers, Jessie Pilz and Hannah Schubert, Mina Markovic, Janja Garmbrandt, Laura Rogora, Jane Kim and Anak Verhoeven, who we were discussing just a second ago. And we got Romain Desgranges available. Romain, congratulations.
Many thanks.
It seems like you get stronger every year. What is the secret?
I don't know. It's incredible.
Are you doing anything differently because you've won the European Championships? You win the first World Cup of the season. What are you doing differently this year?
Yeah, I've changed nothing. Or only training and training again. And always believe I can do it. So I'm really happy today. I make good European championships, and now winning the first World Cup, it's incredible.
And what are your plans for this season? Are you going to do every lead World Cup, and what are your expectations?
Oh yes, I do all competition I can do. I train all the year for competition, so I make everything.
And do you have any hopes or expectations, or you just take every competition one at a time?
I would like to be stronger, like make it possible for Chamonix, but it's a competition we never know.
We do never know, but we know you won today. You've won twice in 2 weeks. Huge congratulations.
Many thanks. Yatta!
I suspect one of his friends dared him to do that. Great to hear from Roman Negroncho.
Yeah.
He just defies age. I mean, had to wait really a long, long time for his first win.
Can you really see he's like a competition maniac, I would say. He's training the whole year just for the competitions. You don't see him too often on the rock or doing something else. But he really wants to be in shape for the competitions. It's like a bit the opposite of Jan Hoyer, which was just here really totally relaxed, not even really trained in endurance or something. And he was really motivated. It's also pretty inspiring to see Roma still so motivated and to be training and to competing. He was just saying he wanted to compete at all the competitions this year, and I think it's inspiring for all the youth out here who are only 16 and have a big career in front of them.
And also inspiring for people that have been competing for a long time and maybe haven't had that big result. I mean, he was plugging away for years and years and years, and it seemed like once he won, they just keep coming. He's now won a World Cup every one of the last three seasons.
So now we have the women's presentation, and we have the first climber out here, which is Hannah Schubert.
Yes, Hannah Schubert, really looking forward to seeing her climb, sister of Jakob. Another climber who we spoke to earlier, seems to be a common theme today, and she said climbing with no pressure. It seems to be something a lot of the climbers have said today, and it's certainly worked very well. So she's out armed with her binoculars. As a compatriot, Jesse Pilz. Four finals in 2016 for Jesse Pilz, got a second in Briançon. Third last week in the European Championships. Here's Mathilde Becerra. Slowly but surely becoming a very experienced competitor, Mathilde. First World Cup 2009, 8 years ago. Made the final in Briançon, Arco and Cran in 2016, but not here in Villars. She corrects that this year. Just been described by the venue MC, Christopher, as a legend, Mina Markovic.
And now we have my compatriot, Anneke Verhoeven. We had a quite big team in Villars this year. We had five semi-finalists.
Yeah,
here's Anneke.
Also had Celine and Chloe in the women's.
Yeah, and we had Nico Collin in the males as well in the semi-finals. Anneke and Janja didn't climb the best in the semi-finals. Anneke somehow slipped somewhere up the semi-final route, and Janja also had a bit of a struggle in the semi-finals.
Here's Janja Gambret.
Because we are too often used to see Anneke and Janja first after semi-finals. And it's quite interesting to see them Not first tied after the semifinals.
Laura Gore of Italy, 16 years old, first World Cup, into the final. Third in the Youth B leading Guangzhou Youth World Championships back in November last year. If there were any nerves, then she certainly didn't show them.
You can see she's quite smaller than Yanya and the rest of the climbers, which means she will have to commit a bit more than the rest of the climbers.
Jane Kim, vastly experienced. Qualified first into this final. And the 6 minutes of observation begins, and the climbers all go straight for that first hole. Just interestingly, we hope it doesn't come to this, but Anak and Yanya were tied in the qualifiers. They were also tied in the semi-final. If they tie their score in the final and they are in first, second or third, it will come down to time on the route. It's only if they're in first, second and third. If they end up fourth and fifth or sixth and seventh, it doesn't matter. They just end up tied, so they would be joint fifth, joint sixth. However, if they're in the podium positions, this is only Anak and Yanya, and they tie on the same score, it will come down to time on this final route. That doesn't apply to any of the other competitors, though. There's what we call separation everywhere else. And much as we saw with the men, the women slowly make their way back towards the edge of the stage and then off it.
Yeah, we can see Yanya and Mina reading together, and Jesse and Hannah are doing the same. So this is a bit of kind of a country solidarity, I would say.
Interesting for Laura Gore as well, as I say, 16 years old from Rome, and she's just on her own in a World Cup final. Seems to be quite happy just quietly checking out the route. Calm as you like. Jane Kim is down the front. You might be able to just make her out there in the white jacket in amongst all the officials and photographers. Now she moves to the back of the group. She seems to have a monopoly on third in 2016 in the lead, four times in World Cup and in the Asian Continental Championships. Very much capable of winning, though. Quick question on Twitter from Stephanie Fan. She'd like to know the ratio of female to male among the route setting teams at IFSC. Well, generally the route setting teams are all male, but we would like to see some female route setters, and don't want to name any names, but there are some strong female route setters coming through, and we'd love to see them at the IFSC. But certainly this competition so far in 2017, they have been all male teams. If there are any strong female route setters out there beyond the ones I know of, make yourselves known.
Exactly.
There's Laura. She's only 16. She's really small. If anything, looks younger than 16. But when she gets on the wall, she climbs like an old person, and which is a compliment.
Yeah, in the semi-final, she had a really struggle on a. On the start of the route, there was this really far movement, and she struggled around for a minute or so to just do this movement because she was just a bit too small. And then when she did it, she just climbed almost to the top, and you could really see she had a lot of endurance. So hopefully the route won't be too reachy for her, or she will have to make some risky movements. The route itself has a pretty easy start, from what the routeer said. Then you have a lot of volumes with each time a hole screwed on it. and there are a lot of holes having some dual texture as well. So hopefully we won't see too many slips like we saw some in the mail. And then we have this very, very end.
Yeah, we mentioned it earlier, kind of a spooky finish. You've got to rock onto that slab. And it's going to be a case of just gradually standing up on it and then at some point committing to go for the top hole. There's a perfect view of it all. Yeah, your mounted camera's right next to it.
You're actually just standing, so it's not really based on your physical capabilities. It will be just, can you dare? Do you have enough time to top it? Are you focused enough? And are you just committing to the final hole?
Yeah, it's a really fun move for the route setters to have put right at the end of the route, because as you say, it won't be physical, but you'll be shaking from the exertion, from the adrenaline, and you suddenly got to shut all that down and try and make one final move to a top.
Yeah, you better not have any shaky legs up there.
And after what's come before, it's going to be very difficult not to be shaken. That's a really interesting, unusual piece of route setting. Hannah Schubert, Yandy Garnbret swapping beta. We saw Hannah chatting to Laura Rigori just a minute ago. I have to say, one thing I would love to see is a microphone in amongst them. I would love to hear this.
Would be, maybe I can guess. So, would you cross here? Yeah, no, I would not cross. Okay, there we match. Okay, yeah, we agree. But yeah, it's not always like the betas can always change when you climb. So sometimes we have several options in mind, and when we climb, then we just feel it. So we know there are maybe two or three ways to do the movements, and when we are actually climbing, then we just feel which way is the best way to do it. And we try to never really have a fixed way to do the routes. There is always a part of improvisation while climbing.
Climbers make their way back into the isolation of the call zone, as it's referred, which is just behind the wall. Jane Kim sneaking one last look. Do you have any techniques when you get back behind the wall to try and remember everything you've seen?
Yeah, well, often the first thing, if I have any doubt or any more questions, then I talk about it with the other climbers. And then I really try to visualize the route in my head, and I am just climbing the route again and again.
To try and climb from the bottom to the top, exactly. Repeatedly.
Yeah. And then it almost feels like I've already climbed the route.
Do you try and focus on the crux moves, or do you just try and do it in one continuous go?
One continuously go, because if you fix too much on the crux move, then you might slip somewhere else, or when you arrive at the crux and you have been focusing only on this move. I don't know, I prefer to have a global view on the route and not to be too concentrated on one movement, otherwise you might be too relaxed after that movement, or you might be too relaxed before the movement. So I think it's better to have like a general view of the route. And it's also pretty hard to know which sequence will be the crux sequence. Sometimes you're expecting a crux somewhere, and actually the hole is much better than expected, so it's hard to guess at advance.
Put points on Twitter, hashtag IFSCWC, if you got any questions for elite lead climber Lurk Timmermans. John Redshaw comments, he's loving the age range in the women's final, inspiring.
Yeah,
certainly is. Mina Markovic, born in 1987. Jane Kim, 1988. Laura Rigora, 2001. Yandy Garnbret, 99. Extraordinary spread of ages. This women's final. Good point, John.
And this was actually also the case in the men's, when we saw Roma winning. And then you had Fedir, who placed his first podium, and he's still in the juniors. So it's really amazing to see, yeah, all the climbers from all ages, all heights, just climbing. Great sport.
And Christoph Bion, the technical delegate, gets the spotlight. I think the operator might have been expecting Hannah Schubert. Always good when we get the crowd on the big screen. It's normally quite a good opportunity to do some celebrity climber spotting. We saw Stanislav Kokorin earlier on. And as you can see, the wall now fully illuminated here in Villars. On the left, the speed wall. We had the final last night. Christopher, the MC, asks the venue, would you like a world champion or not? We are waiting for them.
I think Petra Klingler is in the...
Yeah, I saw Petra Klingler crowd earlier, and I think Christopher's hoping to get her on the microphone. We shall see. Yeah, Petra's here just as a spectator, I might add. She was suffering, you might remember, from Mumbai, suffering with a succession of injuries. She was a lady who needed a rest. She's just here, maybe drinking a couple of beers and enjoying the show. And here's what Hannah Schubert thought of the semi-finals.
The semi-final was really cool and I felt really good when I climbed. I couldn't really show all I've got because the move where I fell was a bit weird and I wanted to do it statically, but I was a bit too short, and then I had to change my mind and try it dynamically. But I think I could have climbed a lot better and maybe a few more moves. But I'm really, really happy that it was enough for the finals. I'm really, really happy and I'm really looking forward to climb tonight. I don't really have any expectations. I'm just glad to be in it and I just want to enjoy it. And I think as starting into the final as eighth, I have nothing to lose and just can climb without any pressure. And I just want to show my best.
As I said, a running theme this evening. Lots of climbers not feeling much pressure.
Yeah, the semi-finals are really the more tricky part of the competition, where everyone is a bit nervous, wants to get in the finals, and once you're in the finals, you're really, really happy and you just want to enjoy the climbing, enjoy the show, the atmosphere. There's a big crowd. The route is really amazing.
So first look at this women's route. Hannah safely through the crimpy start, and now the route leads out and up to the left.
You had a lot of volumes and you don't always see them, but there are some crimpy holes on the volumes there.
And you felt when we were at the foot of the route, the women's route is relatively easy to read, certainly on first appearance.
Yeah, it's not too complicated to read, but you have to find the flow while climbing, and for now she's doing a good job. Now she's maybe swinging to the foothold there, clipping the quick throw. And this is a really nice cross move, facing the crowd.
Nails it. It's really nicely done from Hannah. It's such a strenuous position when you're kind of rotating underneath one hand.
And those footholds you can see on her left foothold, those are actually dual texture footholds, so you really don't want to slip on those holes. Going for the shoulder and the underclink.
She's got 3 minutes 20 left, Hannah. Time will actually become a factor here, not in terms of her score, but just in terms of getting timed out. She's got just over half her time left, but she's not probably a couple of moves short of halfway.
Yeah. And now she has like 2 or 3 more crimpy movements, and then the hard stuff starts, if I may say.
She won't have much opportunity to rest, but 2 minutes 45 left on the clock. We saw in the semi-finals, she climbed really intelligently, shook out constantly, and she used quite a lot of her time, but used it really intelligently, used it really well. Didn't rush, but also made sure she climbed fast enough that getting timed out wasn't a risk.
I think now she's going to keep climbing when she restarted again. Come on.
She was fifth in the last World Cup back in November in Kran, and once again in the final here in Villars. So she feels no pressure. She's going to feel a bit of strain here. This route starts to get extremely physical at this point. Needs to clip.
A far move here. Come on. Nice.
Just see her face really starting to fight. It doesn't look like the easiest position to clip from, Hannah.
And here is the really hard move you have to cross. Up the volume there. The footholds are pretty bad. Come on, Hannah.
Just trying to figure out if there's a slightly easier way of doing it, a slightly better place to put the feet.
Come on. And she's going with right hand. This might be quite intelligent strategically, but too hard for the next move.
Yes, Sutter. Big lunge at the next hole, but not quite enough. You can see the fatigue was really beginning to kick in those last couple of moves. 1 minute 30 she ended up with left on her time. So again, used the time intelligently, rested when she felt she could.
Yeah, and she was feeling that she couldn't cross on the crux move there. So she decided to go again and go with the wrong hand and then do a desperate move. But at least she had the points of the hole there, so might be pretty a tactical way to do it.
Her compatriot Jessie Pilz makes her way out onto the wall. Fifth in the last World Championships, third in the last European Championships. Four finals in 2016, made the final of every lead World Cup in 2015. She's had her individual observation time. Remember, the climbers, as well as the group observation, they also get a short period of time to observe the route just before they start climbing, just to compose themselves, have a last look.
Jesse is the same age as Anak. They've been rivals for years in the youth categories. Jesse won the World Championships quite often. Anak won it once, and it's really nice to see them continue the battle even in the senior categories. Jesse has been a bit injured this year, I believe, in the start of the year. I think she's still suffering a bit of her ankle, I think.
Yeah, she was having one or two issues earlier on this season. It's good to see she made the first World Cup, and how, made the final.
Yeah, I know also Magdalena Rock from Austria is suffering from an injury since the start of the year. But she's training hard again to come back soon this year. So hopefully she will come back.
Jesse just chalking up before these dynamic moves. This is a cross-through move. We suspect that's the only way to do it. We often prove wrong by the climber's imagination. Very shortly we'll be able to speak to Hannah Schubert while her compatriot Jesse Pilz heads up to where Hannah was at the rest.
She's cruising.
And Hannah Schubert is there. Hannah, you said all you wanted to do was enjoy the climb. Did you enjoy it?
Yeah, I definitely enjoy it. I think it's hard to not enjoy a climb in a World Cup final, even especially if it's your second World Cup final ever. But yeah, I think I could have done better, but yeah, whatever.
What do you feel you would do differently if you could do the ruse again?
Not think about climbing too much and just go on, like just do the moves without thinking, like not stay at one spot too much. And yeah, where I fell, I definitely had the wrong hand there, but I knew that. I just wanted to hold the next hold because I thought maybe it's good to have it as an adult. I mean,
because otherwise I think I would have fallen and just had a plus, and I wanted to hold it. So, yeah.
Well, really enjoyed watching you, and I'm really pleased you enjoyed it as well. Thank you for talking to us.
Thank you very much.
Jesse is arriving at the sequence where Hannah fell. So there you should cross to the next hole. And Hannah couldn't do it anymore, so she decided to go again in order to have the points of the next hole. But Jesse sticks the move.
Yeah, interesting to hear Hannah say that.
Yeah, sometimes when you're pumped, you have to be tactical, and that's what she did. Come on, Jesse.
So Jesse lines it up and she sticks it, no problem. Now it's a case of getting the body over to the right. Just trying to figure out whether to swing the feet or go with the hands. I think she's going to go with the hands.
And there is yet another cross here. Come on. And now there are some pinches. Come on. She's really fighting right now.
This Villars crowd loving this from Jesse Pilz.
Next movement is a really big movement to the flat hole. You really have to commit for the next movement. Come on, nice. Now you have to swing the feet to the right.
You can see the tiredness really kicking in with Jesse Pilz.
That hole looks really, really bad. It's only based on friction.
And there it shows. She comes off on the first hold on the head wall of the route. So she'll take an early lead.
Good performance of Jesse.
Yeah, she was really fighting a couple of moves before that, and it looked like she regained some strength. And then another physical section. And a bit like we saw with Romain de Grand struggling to untie. So we've had the two Austrian climbers. Interestingly enough, you can see a stopwatch on Jesse's harness there. Pink stopwatch. We've seen Anouk Verhoeven in the past climbing with a watch on. With the new 6-minute rule, time increasingly important.
Yeah, I think the watch can be interesting in this route, but maybe more for the really, really top of the route. For the rest, I think the route is not too long.
So there we can see the difference between Hannah Schubert and Jesse Pilz. Jesse, as I say, on that first big hold on the head wall.
Yeah, she was only, there were maybe 3 or 4 more moves needed before grabbing the big green hole, and then you have the mantle. Now we see Mathilde reading the route again before the climb. Climbers have 40 seconds before starting the route to have the last read.
And again, she starts her watch. We didn't see it quite so much in the past when there was 8 minutes, particularly on shorter walls like this in Villars, where 8 minutes is plenty of time, maybe an inch, but seems virtually all the competitors now taking a watch with them on their harness. Very happy looking Hannah Schubert just walked past. Mathilde Becerra made finals in Briançon, Arco and Caran last year, but not here in Villars. This time she does. Also competes in bouldering and speed competitions. All-round athlete. The unavoidable elephant in the room is that the Olympics is coming up. Mathilde off already. She looks
distraught. I didn't actually see what happened, but I think she slipped somewhere, or...
Let's try and have another look at that. That was really disappointing for Mathilde. Let's have another look. So she was just setting herself. Let's see what goes...
Yeah, actually, it's a little mistake as well, because normally you have to go behind the volume to the green hole and put a heel hook in order to get this anchoring there. And she decided to go straight to the hole, and this was maybe a bit too risky, and she slipped there.
Yeah, I was about to say, with the Olympics coming up, all-round athletes like Mathilde are going to become increasingly prominent. But not her night here in Villars. Next up, Mina Markovic.
Mina looks really in shape this year. From the start of the season, last week in the European Championship, she was really looking in shape. So I think we might see her climbing really high in the route. And also I think the route can shoot her. There are a lot of creams. I think she really likes them.
Yeah, Mina. She won't thank me for saying it, but the oldest competitor in this evening's women's final, but she's been training super hard since the start of the year for this lead season. She actually provisionally retired at the end of 2015. Changed her mind. She's back with a bang. Won 20 lead World Cups and looks in the form of her life. And as we've seen with Romain Legrange, hitting your 30s,
she's really
certainly not mean the end of your climbing career.
She's not taking any rest.
And we've got Jesse Pilz available. Jesse, congratulations, you have the lead.
Thanks.
How did you find the route?
I liked it. It was really crimpy, but yeah, nice moves and yeah.
How do you feel your form is in 2017?
I think not that good, and it was 2 years ago, but I had some injuries in the last year and this year, and yeah, I think it's getting better.
And your injuries now, are they still a problem, or are you over them now?
No, not anymore, since I think 1 month I can climb normally again. And yeah, my form got better in the last month.
Well, it was great to see you in the final. Thank you very much for talking to us.
Thanks.
That was Jesse Pilz. Focus again on Mina Markovic.
Yeah, she was just saying the route was really crimpy. So, again, I think this is something that might suit Mina. And for the moment, I don't see any trouble in her climbing.
Interestingly enough, this was the only final she did make in 2016, Villars. Made amends this time, and as you say, looking very smooth. Needs to go with commitment here, and she does. Keep an eye on the top of your screen, the results will be coming across. And she decides to go with the feet, and she's up into the volumes.
Let's see how she managed to grab the flat hold after.
It's a good angle, you can see Mina's face and the strain not really showing yet. She looks relatively comfortable. That's a pretty powerful place to try and rest though. Now she goes to the big volume on the head wall. swings her feet across. She's back onto tiny crimps from that, here.
That hole is really, really bad. Come on, Mina. Come on, wow. Come on.
Mina Markovic really having to fight here. The crowd getting behind her. That is the last clip. No more quick draws after this one. She is running for the top.
She has two more moves before grabbing the last holds before the final push. Come on, Mina. So one more move. Come on.
This is the last crimp before she gets onto that huge triangle of volume. There it is.
You have to jump a bit. Come on, Mina. Go for it. Nice.
Just about makes it stick. She's actually smiling. There we go. The perfect angle. She's got a minute and 10 seconds left.
And now it's the mental. Come on, Mina.
Oh, this is an amazing performance from Mina Markovic. This is the slab we talked about. Suddenly you have to calm yourself down.
And you have to push on your legs.
Push on the legs. Try and quell the adrenaline.
This is the final section of a lead World Cup. It's not a bowling World Cup. It's a lead World Cup. Come on, Mina.
So, Mina. Got 35 seconds. There's no quick draws or clips. She's just pulling up a bit of slack so that she can move comfortably.
Jump.
She's edging her way up. Come she could on. Be edging her way to a top here.
Oh.
Mina Markovic had a hand on the top hole. Can't quite top the route, but an amazing performance.
I'm wondering if she was a bit scared up there.
Yeah, you could see she pulled a bit of rope up just to make sure that she had a clean fall. There was no danger of the rope snagging. Let's have another look at it. This was pulling onto the volume. This move, she just about stuck. That is fingertip stuff.
And there you can see the smile on her face. Amazing, you don't see that quite often.
And this was the final move, so she was...
But she actually fell a bit... When she pushed, she was already going...
Yeah, she went yeah. Once, lost some momentum and tried to go again. Probably knew she wasn't going to make it, but she did touch the top hold. So, Anna Grahoven.
That's the moment where my hands get sweaty. Come on, Anak.
She comes into this in exceptional form. She won the last World Cup, albeit it was in November 2016, but it was our last lead World Cup, and she's recently won the European Championships. Can't get much better momentum than that.
Yeah, I can really tell you that she's training really hard. I train sometimes in Perth, and she's climbing there as well quite often. And she's just climbing a lot of ACs, really hard routes. She's climbing really a lot of routes in a climbing session. So endurance won't be a problem for her in this route, I think.
Quick question, actually. We've just seen Mina Markovic on that very top move. There's a question from Ozzy on Twitter. How important do you think show factor is in route setting for the IFSC?
I think it's getting more and more important right now. We can really easily see it with this kind of finals today with the men's and the women's. I think it's good to have some show element in the routes, but the main factor should still be the endurance, and especially in lead climbing. So if the route is hard enough until the last section, and if it's not only based on one spectacular move, I think it's really, really cool to have this kind of move.
Yeah, it's a good point you make. If the route is well set, you don't necessarily need that show element. because it's hard and you see the world's best climbers struggling on it.
Yeah.
Thanks for the question, Ozzy. We are seeing that more and more bouldering type holds appearing on the lead routes. The route setters really trying to create a show. And the best show you can create is have a route that spits the climbers off at different stages. It's lots of different moves, and we've already seen Anak complete the spectacular cross-through move, and she's now onto the small crimps.
She's really climbing fluently for the moment.
Very smooth so far from Anak. Seemingly untroubled at this stage.
Yeah, she has a really, really precise climbing. She don't often make mistakes. She did slip in the semi-finals, but I don't think that will happen twice on the same day. She's even resting in this pretty hard move, so I think you can really say she's fresh.
Just lining up the moves to the right now onto those two almost symmetrical green volumes. Second to last quick draw, the one you can see hanging at the top of your screen on the top right, just next to the IFSC logo. That is the last quick draw. There it is.
Now starts the bit more harder part with the big sloper. Come on, Anak. Let's see how she's doing this move. Come on, Anak. Nice. That was a close one.
And we'll keep an eye on Anak Rahoven. Meanwhile, we've got Mina Markovic. Mina, it looked like you really enjoyed the climb. Looks like we're having... Mina, can you hear me? Looks like we're having one or two technical problems. And in the meantime... a very disappointed looking Anak Verhoeven. It was that move up to the green volume. Apologies for that, we did have Mina Markovic.
Yeah, I hear you now.
Ah, you hear me now, there we go. Mina, it looked like you had a lot of fun on the route. Looked like you were enjoying it.
Yeah, definitely. I found the route really interesting, really nice, and I enjoy a lot. It was a really good mixture of everything. So I really enjoy all the way to the top, also the mantle, but I was a bit scared because I started to feel my elbow. But the jump on the top was also super fun, and I'm just a bit regret that I wasn't more aggressive and just jump on.
What happened at the end? Did you just waited for a second?
Actually, I didn't know if I should jump from the lower position or maybe get myself higher and just go. And yes, I hesitated and didn't commit as I should.
Well, you have the lead right now, so enjoy watching the rest of the competition. And who knows, maybe it's enough.
I'm sure the girls will be able to top it.
Thanks, Mina.
Thank you.
Yeah, I wouldn't be so sure of that because Anak was really cruising until this part and she just fell at this very richy move there.
Here's what Yanya thought after her semi-final before he watched her in the final.
My form, yeah, it's not like I wanted. I trained lead maybe 2 weeks before the European Championship, but yeah, it's getting better. Well, the semi-final routes were really awesome to climb, really good hold, some good rest, but you know, you had to climb fast because of the limited time. So yeah, it was really cool. The conditions were not the best, especially for the last 10 climbers, I think. So yeah, I slipped near the top, but I'm happy with my performance. Yeah, well, it all depends on the style of the route. So yeah, we will see. Hopefully, of course, I will enjoy. But yeah, I really want to win. But yeah, we will see.
And Janu's out now. As I mentioned, if she ties with Anna Grahoven, who we saw falling from very close to the top of the route, it will come down to time on the final route, because they are tied in all of rounds so far here in Villars. That will only apply if they're in the podium position. So yeah, we were actually chatting to Mina Markovic at the time. Slightly bad timing owing to the technical issues we had a bit earlier with Mina. But Anak fell from the large green volume on the huge pink triangular volume, which is at the top of this Villars wall.
Yeah, this move where Anak fell was looked like a really reachy move. You really have to take a risk and go as far as you can in order to grab this sloper. Anak didn't go far enough, I think. Oh, and Janja is having a great heel, really strange.
Yeah, I don't really know how to describe that. It's kind of a drop knee, heel hook.
Exactly, I would say it. I would call it like that. Janja has a really, really great shape regarding bouldering. Like she said, she has only been training for 2 weeks because she decided to do the bouldering season. But although she only trained for 2 weeks, she's already super strong. And I think the movements will seem pretty easy for her. Now we'll see if she has enough endurance to do them all together. For the moment, she looks really alright.
Keep an eye on the top of your screen. The results coming up now. Mina Markovic leading the way, 42 plus. She touched that top hole. Couldn't hang it. Never really got on top of it. Never looked like hanging it, but touched it. And then had a spectacular flight through the air in front of the Villars Knight.
Anak and Janja is now getting to the harder sequence. Once she will have this Anak link, it really starts to get really hard with the next bad sloper there.
She's got 2 minutes 20 seconds now. Janja.
Come on, Janja. This is the correct sequence.
It's such a physical move, this out to the right. Trip number one.
Yeah. She's still on the wall.
No good solution for where to clip there.
And now this is the reachy moves. Oh, and she's doing it statically.
She is doing it statically. Janja Garnbret,
she just reached for it. It's amazing. Okay, and now it's the mental. I think the fact she's been bouldering a lot will probably help her.
She's just shaking out. 1 minute 30 on the clock, won't need to worry about time. She can really figure this out. The problem is, how much are you really recovering on that hold?
Exactly.
Well, quite a lot it would seem if you're Janja Garnbret.
Come on, Janja. You've been doing bouldering, you know how to do this. You can do it.
Are we about to see a top in this women's route? The Villars crowd come to life again.
Push on the legs. Nice.
She's in a standing position. Now she just needs to figure out how to launch for this jump.
She's taking some rope with her.
Like Mina Markovic, making sure she's got enough slack. The last thing she wants is to be pulled down by the rope. Now she can get a good rest, and she's got 45 seconds on the clock. She's got an opportunity for a pretty good rest here. Both hands are off the wall.
And now let's see the jump. Come on, Janja.
So she'll go.
She's going for the right foot hold.
Right foot. Yeah. Right hip in.
Come on.
Janja Garnbret, winner in Villars 2016.
And she grabs it. Nice.
Tops in Villars 2017. Amazing effort from Janja Garnbret.
And she's in time, 17 seconds left. Amazing.
Is there anything left for this woman to achieve in climbing, even at 18 years old? Just extraordinary. She just continues to surprise us with every competition that comes around. Let's have another look at it. Got the right foot up and got a bit of use out of the left. And as soon as the left foot landed, she launched. It was obviously a very tenuous position.
She really decided to do it in a balancy way. She didn't try to jump to rush it. She really did it smoothly.
Yeah, even at 18 years old, there's so many things Janja Garnbret has already achieved. It already looks like it's a case of how many can she win in her career. It's extraordinary.
Yeah, even if we still have two climbers to go, and if Jan Kim or Laura Rogora top, then there will be comeback and Janja won't be winning.
No, she won't be winning, but she is the first to top this route in Villars.
And we have a really nice view on the moon here.
Have a beautiful view of the moon, yeah. Lovely shot, very arty. But won in Villars 2016. She's done all she can do in the final in 2017. She's claimed the top. Now all she can do is wait. Laura Rogora, if she tops, or if Jane Kim tops, it will come back to count back to the previous round. Janja guaranteed at least a place on the podium, though. There's only two more climbers to come. The worst she can do is third. But as I say, she's just continues to impress us. A climbing sensation. And there's another one on the wall now. Laura Rogora, 16-year-old from Rome in Italy. Sixth in the European Championships a week ago, and there we can see Janja Garnbret top, Mina Markovic in second, Anna Grohoven currently in third place. That's your podium as it stands, two climbers including Laura Rogora. First ever World Cup, and here she is in the final.
Yeah, you can already see she's having a really different sequence of the other climbers, because she's just smaller and she has to take some more risk, and it's just amazing experience for her.
You can see her height counting against her slightly on those lower moves. Should be less of a factor from here on out from what we've seen of the route. That was the key heel hook that Matteo Becerra just missed. Temperature plummeting here in Villars, conditions improving. About midway through this crimpy section on the black volumes, it's green hole to green hole as she makes her way left. And again, this a move.
This is reachy for her.
It is reachy for the shorter climber. Hannah Schubert struggled to make it.
And this movement.
And she's taller than Laura. And we've got Janja Garnbret available to talk to us. Janja, you said that your form, you weren't super happy with your form coming to Villars. That was amazing.
Yeah, it's true. I really enjoyed the route. Just before I start the route, I said to myself, now just relax and it will happen when it's what it's meant to be. So yeah, I'm pretty happy with my performance.
And that last move at the top, you had plenty of time. Was that important? It looked like you just needed some time to calm down.
Yeah, I think the last part near the top was really technical, so you needed to be really calm. So yeah, I was watching down the clock and counting down the seconds till I tried the top, and yeah, it was just enough.
And we've seen you in the Boulder World Cups this year. Do you think that was useful on today's route?
Yeah, of course, the top was of course useful to do some bouldering for the last move, but the overall, you needed to have endurance, because the route was really not that hard till the end, so yeah.
Well, for 2 weeks of lead training, that wasn't too bad at all. We'll let you go and watch the other competitors. Thank you very much for talking to us.
Yeah, thank you so much.
That was Janja Garnbret, who, as I said, said she's only got 2 weeks of lead training in her since the last Boulder World Cup. Seems to have done the job. From one climbing sensation, Janja Garnbret, to another, Laura Agora. Yeah. On the move where we saw Hannah Schubert fall.
And here she will have to commit, because this move is really reachy. Come on. Wow.
Makes it stick. Incredible power in the shoulders.
I think we will hear more from Laura in the next few years, or even weeks.
I think you could be right. You can just see on her face she's really having to fight here. She's giving it everything she's got.
Now she's just having the wrong hand here. She should be with her left hand, and so she's matching. Oh. Poor, that's... Yeah.
That was just a move too far. Laura, she realised, like you said, that she had the wrong hand on that hold, needed the left hand, tried to correct. One of the big advantages, of course, of having small hands, she was almost able to match, but not quite.
But she's having a smile anyway. It's her first final. She can be really happy. The crowd is having a big applause for her.
Yeah, that's a pretty memorable World Cup debut. So Janja Garnbret now guaranteed at least second place. She's just walked past us. She's just about 5 meters away from us. She's just, all she's got to do now is watch Jane Kim. Here's the results as they stand. Just waiting for Laura's score to update. And there we see it. Puts her up into fifth place. So she's guaranteed at least sixth. Mina Markovic and Janja Garnbret both guaranteed a place on the podium. There will be two Slovenians receiving medals in this women's final here in Villa. Can Jane Kim make it onto the podium?
Jane Kim is also the slowest climber, I think. At least she was last year, so it will be interesting to see the clock for her too.
Just to confirm, by the way, I mentioned about the two Slovenians on the podium. Don't forget Dominic Skofic as well. So it's of the six medals handed out this evening, three will be going back to Slovenia. Good evening's work for them. Meanwhile, got Jane Kim on the wall. Know exactly what to expect from her. Smooth, precise climbing. She'll have to commit on a couple of the moves, though. We've seen her in the Boulder World Cups this year. Trying to work, I guess, on that dynamic style. She's going to need some of it today. It's not her natural way of climbing. But a fourth place already in the Boulder World Cups. That was in Nanjing earlier this year. Proves she can do dynamic moves when required.
Yeah, now she has to do them in a row, and also in 6 minutes, so yeah, it's going to be interesting.
Winner of 25 lead World Cups, Jane Kim, and a Boulder World Cup.
Yeah, and I think I've never seen Jane Kim slipping on her route. She's also very, very precise, very smooth.
Yeah, last year we actually filmed a feature with her near Imst in Austria, and I belayed her while she was climbing, and it was awesome to watch her on real rock. It was exactly the same. You could kind of, You could almost be like a robot. You just pay out a meter rope about every 20 seconds. She just kept up a really nice steady pace all the way. Really impressive to watch. Yeah, she makes the cross through move look pretty steady.
She's training in Korea in a small bouldering gym actually with her her brother's bouldering gym. And yeah, it's really impressive to see how strong she became while only training in a really small climbing gym. And she's a legend in Korea. When you go in the subway, you have posters of her everywhere, and random people know her from just for climbing. Three minutes already elapsed with Jane Kim. And she's halfway to the route, I would say.
Yeah, as we saw with Yanya though, it's nice to have a bit of time in hand just to be able to pause for those final moves. She might be glad of a bit of time at the top,
but you don't really want to rush the final movement, so...
She is halfway, but as I say, it'd be nice to get there with a bit of time in hand. Not all the moves on this route take as long as each other. The latter move's certainly a bit slower. 2:30. There won't be as many opportunities to pause for the next few moves though, so she might be able to gain a bit of time, but I have to say, 2:20 on the clock, if she is going to top this, she's going to need to pick up the pace slightly.
Yeah.
Sticks a dynamic move out to the right.
And she's resting again, but I don't know if she has the clock in her mind, but she should start being concerned a bit. And here she will have to match, like Laura. Oh, she's going for the pinch. Normally she has to cross and be with the other hand. Oh, she's crossing. Come on.
Now she's going up to the two green volumes.
This is not really meant by the rooters. But she's passing through anyway. But there is only 1 minute left, so... I don't think that's really enough for Jane Kim to get to the top. Now she's going to have to rush if she wants to see the end of the route.
She really has to rush. 48 seconds on the clock. Sticks a dynamic move.
Come on.
How closely is she following the time?
Oh, no.
And Jane Kim off just as she enters the head wall. A wave to the crowd and a final look up. I suspect she might have been timed out anyway. As it was, she fell before she was timed out. She just has one look back up at the route, Jane. What might have been. Let's have another look at it. It was a swing across to the right. She stuck this. It got both feet across.
Yeah. Her right hand was a bit low on the sloper there, so she couldn't match it properly and she got out of the route.
Jane, She looked a bit disappointed, but I think she enjoyed climbing. It's a long season, plenty of events still to come. Having a quick chat with the venue MC, Christopher. So here are your final results here in Villars. The women first. So Janja Garnbret wins again in Villars, second year running. She won the first four World Cups of 2016. Mina Markovic is second, two Slovenians on the first two steps of the podium, and Anna Grahoven takes third. Jane Kim, we've just seen her, she was fourth. Jessie Pilz, Laura Agoren, her first ever World Cup. Hannah Schubert and Matil Becerra, the rest of the top eight. And in the men's competition, Romain Legrange, like a fine wine, getting better every year. 41 for him was enough for the win. No top in the men's results, in the men's route, but Damon Skofic took third, second, Fede Samarilov took third. Jan Hoyer so close to making it onto the podium in a competition where his aim was to make the semis. Yuki Hada, Christoph Henke, Jörg Verhoeven and Sean Bailey, the rest of the top eight. Loic Timmerman, thank you very much for joining me once again.
Thank you, it was a pleasure.
And a superb final.
Indeed.
And there's the confirmation. Top from Janja Garnbret, Mina Markovic second, Anna Verhoeven in third. Well, fantastic start to the lead season here in Villars. The athletes have just 3 days rest now, and then they're back in action again in Chamonix on the 12th and 13th of August. Hope to see you there.
For the lead climbing woman, mesdames et messieurs, veuillez accueillir les médaillés d'escalade de la difficulté féminine. The medals will be presented by Mr. Marco Maria Scolaris, President of the International Federation of Sports Climbing. Les médailles seront remises par Monsieur Marco Maria Scolaris, Président de la Fédération Internationale d'Escalade Sportive, accompanied by Mr. Jean-Christophe Lac, Tourism and Economic Minister of the City of Villars-sur-Ollon, accompagné de Monsieur Jean-Christophe Lac, Municipal du Tourisme et de l'Économie de la Commune de Villars-sur-Ollon, and by Mr. Marcus Weber, Sport Competition Director of the Swiss Alpine Club, et par Monsieur Marcus Weber, Directeur du Sport de Compétition au Club Alpin Suisse. Bronze medalist representing Belgium. Médaille de bronze représentant la Belgique, Anna Verhoeven. Slovenia, médaille d'argent représentant la Slovénie, Mina Markovic. Medalist and winner of the Villars-sur-Ollon IFSC Lead World Cup 2017, representing Slovenia. Médaille d'or et vainqueur de la Coupe du Monde de difficulté de Villars-sur-Ollon 2017, représentant la Slovénie, Janja Garnbret. gentlemen, please stand for the national anthem from Slovenia. Mesdames et messieurs, veuillez vous lever pour l'hymne national de la Slovénie. Mesdames et messieurs, le podium masculin. For the lead climbing men, mesdames et messieurs, veuillez accueillir les médaillés d'escalade de la difficulté masculine. Will be presented by Mr. Marco Maria Scolaris, President of the International Federation of Sport Climbing. Les médailles seront remises par Monsieur Marco Maria Scolaris, President de la Fédération Internationale d'Escalade Sportive, accompanied by Mr. Jean-Christophe Lac, Tourism and Economic Minister of the City of Villars-sur-Ollon, accompagné de Monsieur Jean-Christophe Lac, Municipal du Tourisme et de l'économie de la commune de Villars-sur-Ollon, and by Mr. Marcus Weber, Sport Competition Director of the Swiss Alpine Club, et par Monsieur Marcus Weber, Directeur du Sport de Compétition au Club Alpin Suisse. Bronze medalist representing Ukraine. Médaille de bronze représentant l'Ukraine, Fedir Samoilov. Representing Slovenia, médaille d'argent, représentant la Slovénie, Domen Skofic. Lyon IFFC Lead World Cup 2017. Representing France, médaillé d'or et vainqueur de la Coupe du Monde de difficulté de Villars-sur-Ollon 2017. Représentant la France, Romain Desgranges. Please stand for the national anthem. Mesdames et messieurs, veuillez vous lever pour l'hymne national français. Il va faire quelque chose qui n'a jamais été fait. Je crois qu'il s'en rappellera toute sa vie. Merci pour le geste. Une montre d'une valeur de 10 000 euros pour le vainqueur. Merci.